Hey guys, how are you all doing tonight? Hope you're having a good night and are ready for some comfy corner. Hoping it'll be a good one and that we'll actually make progress in reading this book. Hopefully. Sorry, I'm moving some things around on my computer. We're using OBS today because I have it set up for recording so that I can upload it to YouTube afterwards. Hi, Jacob. Also, I'm sorry that I'm starting so late tonight, but if you've been watching me on Twitter, you'll know why. If you don't have Twitter, or you haven't been watching me on it, just aren't privy to the information. Essentially, we got new internet today. And, well, new TV as well. And everything, or the current emptiness that is chat. Oh, it happens. But anyway, oh god. Why is my camera all wonky? Camera plus. Oh, it'll even up. I actually need to change it. Too much. There we go. That's a bit better. Okay. But anyway, so we got new TV with new internet. And my room is the room with the router, so all my stuff got unplugged, and yeah, so I had to, plus the setup, my computer is and everything, was pulled out halfway through the room. It was all kind of not fantastic, essentially. Oh, god. Hold on. I need record, please. More. Record. Okay. You have green earphones too? Awesome. Mine are Razer something. I just got them, so I'm super happy about that. But anyway, so my chest or desk thing that has my computer was pulled out, and essentially it was just all around a mess. And I was gonna try and just stream with it, but then Holzbrook ended up coming home, so he moved things around for me, and that just took a lot longer than I thought it would, especially because he wanted to chit-chat, and I don't get to hang out with my brother very often, so we decided to, so I just chatted with him, I guess. Mine were cheap. Mine weren't terribly expensive either, because I got, Random Mike introduced me to, a website that has things for nice and cheap. I'm glad I got on Twitter today. Totally would have been worried about you. I'm glad you got on Twitter too. I'm sorry if I worried anyone. I did not intend to. But I forgot that we were getting new internet today, and it didn't even occur to me that all my stuff would be in the guy's way. So yeah. Brother hype, absolutely. Holzbrook's awesome. Oh my gosh. Allergies are killing me right now, though. Swear to God. Okay. I do... Oops. That is not what I wanted to do. There we go. John Shepherd, thank you for the retweet slash quote, quoted tweet. Oh my gosh, I'm gonna be sniffling all night, I feel like. Okay. I am interested in seeing my speed test currently on the new internet, because I haven't done that yet, because I was too busy trying to set other stuff up. So we're gonna... Oh, I forgot. OBS doesn't like when I do that. Oh well, OBS will just deal. Because I, like I said, I am using OBS tonight because it does the cool thing, well, the cool thing where I don't have to figure out how to get it to record. Once I figure out how to make XSplit record, I may attempt to use XSplit instead of OBS for my comfy corners. Well, my download speed is already decently higher than it was by a good 10 Mbps. I actually got on because I was worried about another streamer who wasn't. Oh, is that other streamer doing all right? On his normal time. Oh, so that's what he got on Twitter. Okay. So, I don't know if this is just because I'm streaming, but the up-down isn't that much better than the last one. So, yay. Joy. Maybe it could just be because I'm streaming, but I don't think it is. I don't actually think that it is. I don't know, we'll see. excuse me. Okay. 10 down and 0.6 up? Oh my gosh, Jacob, that sucks. I'm so sorry. Mine was 33.4. Which, compared to some people I've seen, is not super fantastic, but it could also be my computer. It could. I'm aware that there's a possibility that it could be my computer that's the issue. Also, it's really cold right now, and I don't know why. I thought we turned the heat on, but I'm getting cold air, it feels like. I don't know. Whatever. But 50-50. Nice, Grant. That's awesome. I am extremely jealous. If by 50-50, you're talking about your down-up speed. They were okay. Just had a long night. And that's understandable. I've had that before. Oh, you know what? I'm on the completely... I completely forgot to change what I'm doing. Fiber? What do you mean? What do you mean, Jacob? Verizon Fios, only good product they have. I use Verizon for my phone, but I don't know if that's actually technically a product so much as a service. Oh, fiber optic? It could very well be. There we go. Okay. Surface, I mean, yeah, it's over. Fiber net sounds nice. If you get that kind of internet speed, that's freaking awesome. I'm extremely jealous. Oh my gosh, I'm like half tempted to stand up and turn off my air vent because it's so freaking cold right now. I don't know if we maybe turned the air conditioning back on, but I don't like it. Oh. Are you asking me or Grant, Jacob? SoCal? Nice. I do not live there. I live in so ill. Southern Illinois. Okay. Oh my gosh, why is it cold? Hey, Downshift, how are you tonight? I want by. I kind of do too now. Excuse me. Allergies are gonna kill me tonight, guys. I'm telling you. Just in Chicago? Yeah. Chicago's really cold. It's not like super cold where I am right now, which is probably why the heat is off. But I usually keep my vent closed during the summer because it gets, my room is like, I'm in the basement. And so it's like always really cold, even in the winter. And I have a space heater and everything, but I thought we turned the heat on. And so I opened my vent, but it's definitely blowing cold air. So that's not something I'm happy with, but I'm kind of too lazy to get up and fix it. So. Oh my gosh. I can't already be tired. I just started streaming. Alright. So we are going to read Dragonspell and hopefully make it past chapter 3 this time. So. We will be starting over at the very beginning. And hopefully there won't be any technical difficulties like there were last week. Sleepy rain. Oh no, no. Oh my god. I'm probably just, coming down, from relaxation with talking like this. It's probably just helping me relax. And as a result, that's just kind of making my brain go, okay, rest, and hopefully, yeah, everything will just be really nice. So, for those of you who are not familiar, with our Comfy Corner streams, it has to do with ASMR. And while we're not super heavy on triggers, with the book reading, we do, some tapping, some page tracing, and also I'm not doing whisper reading, I'm just kind of doing, soft spoken to, normal volume. Because I am trying to do more voice acting and such with this. excuse me. Also, my allergies are killing me, and whispering would not work. But yeah, this is still technically, the main goal of these streams. It's just for a nice, relaxing time, to kind of help you just find your calm, possibly fall asleep. That sort of thing. It would be funny if you fell asleep on stream. That would be really amusing. Hopefully it doesn't happen. Excuse me. Hi, Umbreon. How are you tonight? But yeah, so that's what DorkyBot is saying is ASMR in a nutshell, which is kind of what we're going for with a lot of these comfy corner streams. Most of them have to do with reading, but that's only thus far. We haven't had a whole lot of comfy corner streams yet. It's relatively new. And then as far as the book we are reading, we do have a command for that, but it is Dragonspell by Donita K. Paul, and it is one of my favorite books. It's from a series. Hashtag we love Dorky Dorkbot. It is from a series, and we will be reading the full series probably, assuming you guys enjoy it. We'll see. If you guys really don't like it, we won't finish it, but I kind of love it, so. But yeah, it's about dragons, which have a special place in my heart. I'm doing, my allergies are kicking my ass, Umbreon. I'm not sick, I'm just being overrun by allergen and pollen. And it's just getting me really bad with sniffling and coughing. I'm hoping it's just allergies. I'm pretty sure it's just allergies. So I don't feel sick. I just am having trouble with my airways. Yeah, no worries. Thank you. Thank you for the concern, though. I've seen a game streamer pass down on the stream. I forgot his name, though. Oh, man, that's insane. If you like it, I will, because we have great tastes in books. Yee, I adore books. Also, Umbreon, why are you sad? What's wrong, BB? What's happened?
I is worried now.
Why is you sad? No, I have, like I said, I have loved these books for years. It's wonderful. League is upsetting you to the point. Aww. Almost don't even want to play anymore. I am sorry, Umbreon. That really sucks. I hate when games get to that point. That's definitely not any fun. I would love to breathe. Is it other players, or is it the game itself, or... Also, what do you guys think of this background music? Are you able to hear it? And I know last week's the kind of like with the fairy pond or whatever it was called, people found it a little bit creepy with like the frog noises and everything, I guess. So hopefully, I'm hoping this one isn't. I'm hoping this one's pretty good tonight. It's a cave chime. So. Umbreon, you could try taking a tolerance break. What's a tolerance break? Also, Jerex, welcome to the stream. I have not started the book yet, no. Vash Atomic. As far as, what my brother calls me, he refers to me as his sister. So, which, I mean, I've been used to for my entire life, so I'm cool with that. I will occasionally refer to myself as his sibling and just say, you know, that I'm just, you know, his sibling. But he does refer to me as sister, so. Tanks are supposed to take the damage for the others to deal the damage, not to be able to deal more damage than the others can deal and still take everything. Oh, I see, Umbreon. I'm sorry, it sounds like people are not playing their part correctly. Good, I didn't miss anything. Yeah, no worries. I started really late tonight. So, we haven't even gotten to the book yet. Hey, Wolfang. How are you tonight? So, I'm hoping we'll take a decent chunk out of this book tonight. If we make it past chapter 3, I will be happy. Not gonna lie. And they're not very long chapters. Like, this here, this far in, page 24 is chapter 5. So, if we can make it that far, we will have accomplished more than we have in the past. And if my computer decides to behave and cooperate, that would be excellent. I'm good. Glad to hear it, Wolfang. Glad to hear it. Chapter 3 hype! Well, we're gonna be starting from the beginning, because I don't really have any of this on YouTube yet, and I do want to upload these stories to YouTube so that people can, if, you know, they miss part of the stream, or if they come in, later in, the series, or what have you, or they fall asleep or something, excuse me, hoping that they'll be able to, I want to have these up on YouTube so that they can catch up, and possibly, not gonna lie, there's a little tiny bit of hope that I might get discovered by a audiobook place. Probably not gonna happen, but one can dream. So, we will be starting from the beginning. And let's go ahead and get started before I go on for too much longer. Oh, let's see. Creators of League made it so that the tanks can take so much damage and deal even more damage than they can take. It's super annoying. Not only that, but people are taking teams that use nothing but immobilizes and stuns or stuff like that. So it sucks, and it's just no longer fun. Oh, I'm sorry, Umbreon. That does not sound like, an enjoyable gameplay. Kind of sucks. I really wish people weren't doing that. That's rude, in my opinion. But I don't know, it's probably just because I'm bad at games and it's like, okay, people, be nicer to me because I suck. I would love to be a voice actor, but I'd need training. I have been trying to teach myself voice acting. And I've been thinking about taking some classes or something, see if I can figure that out, but it's something I really enjoy, whether or not I can ever, monetize that, like, as a job or what have you, it would be nice, but, I don't think it's high on my priority list. Currently. It's not high on my priority list currently. It used to be really high. When I first got this microphone, the Blue Yeti, was, oh god, 4 years ago? I think? 3 or 4 years ago. And, I was really big on the idea of being a voice actor. And so I purchased this microphone for that purpose. I have since kind of fallen in love with streaming. And while I would adore being a voice actor, it's not a main focus for me. I guess it's not that it's not a priority. It's just, it's not my main focus currently. So, Fred Newman. Yes, I just can't remember what he does. I'm really, really bad with names. I'm very bad with names, Jacob. But I know I've heard it. I love listening to your voice, relaxing. Oh, thank you, Vash. That is definitely, what I try for on the comfy corners. Even with, changing it up and changing my voice for, books. I've heard that learning to voice act helps in other ways than just acting. Oh, really? I know it definitely helped me when I, worked as a... Oh, Doug! Yes! Wait, Doug the dog? Or Doug as in... It's probably Doug from the dog. Up. From Up. That's what it was. Prairie Home Companion and Reading Rainbow. Oh, nice. Mouth sounds nice. That sounds interesting. Oh, I loved Reading Rainbow. Okay. So, I know not everyone in my chat is a Rooster Teeth fan. However, if any of you grew up with Reading Rainbow, this will, like, blow your minds, and it's the coolest thing ever. The guy who... The Reading Rainbow guy. I forgot his name. How could I forget his name? With Skeeter, who is blue. So, do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Okay. That's what I originally thought, and then I was like, oh wait, maybe the dog. But yes, I loved Doug. I adored Doug. Saturday morning cartoons, ah. But anyway, so the guy who did Reading Rainbow, whose name has just, like, completely lost my mind. LeVar Burton. Thank you, Grant. Thank you. LeVar Burton. A.K.A. the Reading Rainbow guy, A.K.A. the dude from Star Trek Next Generation, the dude with the eyes. Anyway, he, last year, Rooster Teeth always does an Extra Life thing, and last year they had LeVar Burton on their Extra Life stream. And it was the coolest thing, because they had him playing video games with them, one of the best things for me was he read the book that he has written. He's written a children's book, and he read that aloud to everyone, like, Reading Rainbow style, everyone gathered on the floor. Geordi LaForge, or Geordi LaForge, I never got into Star Trek. My mom loved it, though. And then the coolest part for me was, at a certain, donation level, he read Go the Fuck to Sleep. As if, like, Reading Rainbow style. And it was the coolest thing ever. And I'm so jealous of them that I got to meet one of my idols. He's the reason I've always loved, or one of the main reasons I've always loved books and always loved audiobooks was LeVar Burton and Reading Rainbow. So, that's so cool. But yeah. What were we talking about before that? NPR would hire you in a heartbeat. Aw, thank you, Grant. I've heard that learning to voice act helps in other ways than just relaxing. Or just acting. Wow, I can't say words. I can't read words. But yeah, so like, what other ways, besides, I'm just curious, like, how other ways, oh, because I know for me, it did help when I had a job, as a receptionist, or, I guess kind of receptionist, enunciate, it helped me make sure that my voice sounded more professional when I was answering the phone and such, but I'm curious, like, as to what other ways, because even that was still voice acting. I kind of put myself into a different character mindset, to have my voice do different things. So I'm a little bit curious about that. But I do need to get to the book, because we've been live for half an hour, and I haven't read any of the book yet. I'm trying to do some ASMR trigger sounds. I should put it in my other headphone too. There we go. Ooh, dragons and titans. That sounds awesome, Umbreon. Are the dragons good guys? Or can they be good guys at least? Let's get started with the book. Chapter 1. Almost there. Are you sure you won't ride all the way into the city? Kale hardly heard the farmer's question as she stood beside his wagon load of barley grain. Her eyes looked over the crude cart she traveled in, and then turned to the dazzling metropolis across the wide valley. The sun sparkled on Vindala, a city of sheer white walls, shining blue roofs and golden domes. Many spires and steeples and turrets towered above the city, but in a vast variety of shapes and colors. More than a dozen castles clustered outside the capital, and more palaces were scattered over the landscape across the wide river. Seeing Vindala reminded Kale her life had changed forever. Her hand rose to her chest and rested on the small pouch hidden under her clothes. I have a destiny. The thought scared her, and pleased her too. After being a village slave all 14 years of her life, she'd been freed. Well, sort of free. Less than a month ago, she left River Away, her village of 24 homes, a shop, a tavern, and a meeting house. In maybe another week, she'd go through the tall gates of the most beautiful walled city in all of Amara, quite possibly in the entire civilized world. It would take a week to get used to the clamor. She could feel it from here. I'd go mad in my head if I stepped into Vindala tonight. The city pulsated with thoughts and feelings of more people than she could count. On market day in River Away, she endured 30 or 40 people close enough for her to feel their lives bumping against the walls of her inner person. But Vindala... I might smother. I'll go slowly into that city. Nobody knows I'm coming. I don't have to hurry. A mile or so a day, slow, until it feels comfortable. A lot of things worried her. It was easy to say you were glad not to be a slave any longer. It was hard to walk alone into a place you'd never been before. Nobody knew or cared about her in Vindala. In River Away, most everybody cared. Even if the caring revolved around whether or not she worked hard.
Girl!
The old man's bark jerked Kale from her thoughts. He scowled at her. I'm going right into the city. You might as well take a ride with me. Thank you, Farmer Brig, but I'd just as soon walk the rest of the way. I can look at how pretty Vendella is. She smiled up at him, feeling some affection for the gruff old man. She'd ridden the last leg of her journey beside him, on the wide wooden seat. He'd been kind to her, sharing his bread and cheese and stories of all the wonders in the great city. Nevertheless, Kale would not be rushed into entering Vendella. She'd do it in her own time. You're headed for the hall, aren't you? His pale blue eyes twinkled under bushy gray eyebrows. Kale didn't answer. To say yes would give away more about herself than she intended. Not such a good idea, trusting someone outside your own village. Even a grandfatherly, talkative old farmer. Alright, let me see. You ride them, it looks like, and you fight on them as well. That sounds awesome, Umbria. Umbreon, I need to play it. DM me a link in Twitter. Have you seen Flight of Dragons? Is it a movie? Flight of Dragons. That sounds vaguely familiar. Let me see. Looks like it is a movie. Trying to see if I've seen it. I have not. It's an animated movie? I have not seen it. That looks cool. I'll have to see if I can find it somewhere. I'm gonna leave that up so that I can find it later. Okay. Well, I see you're not going to tell me. He winked at her and then looked off to the city, his expression growing grim. Should you get into any trouble, go to the Goose in the Gander Tavern, North City. Ask for May. Tell her you're a friend of mine. She'll help you if she can. I will, said Kale, and waved goodbye to the old man, before trudging up the hill, away from the road. She listened to the squeak of the axle and creak of the wheels, but didn't turn to watch the farmer's wagon lumber down the sloping road. Among an hour's worth of advice, Mistress Miger had said to keep her focus on what's ahead. Kale sighed. Mistress Miger knows best. Lush, gorse bushes covered the grassy slope. The hill nestled right against one of the mountains. Farmer Brig had known the names of all the peaks in the mountain range. His stories of how these names came to be fascinated Kale, but it was tales of Vendella that caught her attention. After all, Vendella would be her home. Just over the rise, she found a place to settle. She sat with her back to a gum tree, her bare feet propped up on a stone outcropping. She rested her arms on knees pulled up to her chin, and her chin on her folded arms. Then, Kale took a long, peaceful breath of the hot summer air and allowed herself the luxury. Excuse me. And allowed herself the luxury of gazing at beautiful Vendella. The twisting spires and floating spheres were beyond anything she had imagined. The whole scene looked like a magical picture, clean and bright and full of promise. Pulling the thong at her neck, Kale drew out a soft, scarlet pouch. She placed it between her hands, gently rubbing the material, enjoying the satin finish, elated by the secret of the stone-like egg within. The egg warmed, responding to her excitement. It thrummed. The gentle vibration communicated joy and anticipation through Kale's sensitive fingers. With her eyes back on the city, Kale talked aloud. In a week, we'll be going to the hall. I'll be a servant of the people then, not a slave. That's higher class than I ever dreamed of being. Fancy food, fancy clothes, fancy education. She smoothed the silky cloth at her throat with one rough hand. Mistress Miger had given her the long blue scarf the night her husband died. Chief Councilman Miger... I'm sorry. He did not die. I apologize. The long blue scarf the night her husband, Chief Councilman Miger, told Kale to go to Vendela. The rest of Kale's homespun attire reflected her social status. Her trousers had two patches, one at the knee and one at the seat. She wore shirts, a tunic, and the blue scarf. Travel dust covered every inch of her. She'd find a stream to clean up before entering Vendela. A new life awaited her in that beautiful city. Not one person in all of River Away remembered a time when a local had been sent to the hall. Master Miger said to hold the honor tight. Kale held it tight, all right, if only to convince herself she wasn't scared like a squawking peeper fallen out of the nest. Focus on what's ahead. We'll travel and do Paladin's bidding. She grinned at that. Sounds pretty high and mighty for the likes of me. For a few moments, she stared at the fairy tale castles surrounding the walled city. Seven bridges in jewel colors crossed the Pomandando River on the eastern side. Each bridge led to a towering entrance to the inner city. People from each of the seven high races crossed those bridges at one time or another, she whispered. The wall in the Riverway Tavern had a mural of a brotherhood marching across a mountain pass. Each of the races was represented. Crudely drawn, the figures nonetheless looked excited to be adventuring. Kale imagined a similar procession, crossing one of the great bridges. Bantam Daniels, Giant Uroms, the Elegant Immerlindians, Fighting Miriams, Truman Hoffers, Swift Kimmins, and Orants. Kale sighed. Orants like me. Chief Councilman Miger said he thought I was an Orant, though he'd never seen one. Another reason for me to go to the hall, he said. She squinted as a large, dark shape swooped over the far mountains and headed for Vendela. She jumped to her feet and could not keep from bouncing on her toes as she recognized a greater dragon. It circled the city, a dark silhouette passing in front of the iridescent white towers. Kale tucked the pouch safely back into her shirt and scrambled up the steep hillside, hoping for a better view. She stopped and gave a whoop as she saw two more of the majestic creatures crest the mountains and make a downward approach to Vendela. Climbing the sharp incline on her hands and knees now, Kale grabbed branches and jagged rocks to hoist herself up. She topped the embankment and rolled over the edge. Guttural shouts greeted her arrival. Rough, hairy hands grabbed her arms and legs. A putrid smell filled her nose, and her mouth watered in revulsion. Her stomach lurched. Grawlix? Kale had heard tells told in the tavern. Nothing smelled as bad as the mountain ogres. She saw dark, hairy legs, a leather loincloth, tattered cloth hanging over a barrel chest, fat lips, yellow teeth, a grossly fat, flabby nose, and tiny eyes, solidly black. Grawlix! Two of the mountain ogres flipped her through the air. Her muscles tightened as she expected to come crashing down among the rocks. Instead, another Grawlix snatched her before she hit the ground, and a screech ripped from her mouth. A burst of raucous laughter greeted her alarm. Her captors joyfully sped up their game of toss. Her captors joyfully sped up their game of toss. There we go. I can read words. One Grawlig claimed her as his prize. He slung her over his shoulder, his hard muscles smashing into her middle, forcing the air from her lungs. He gave a hoot of triumph and ran around the crude camp with the others chasing him. Kale hung upside down with her arms dangling. Her face bounced into the oily, matted hair on his back. "They'll kill me. They'll play with me, then kill me." The Grawlig's beefy hands tightened on her thighs, and she felt herself swung in an arc over his head. He jumped and twisted, performing some kind of ritual dance with the others, howling and gyrating around them. Kale desperately tried to pull in one cleansing breath of air.
Stupid O-Rant,"
the ogre's taunt filled her ears.
"We heard you coming."
He released Kale and launched her frail body across the clearing toward the ridge she had climbed. Just before she sailed over the 30-foot drop, another Grawlig caught her by an arm and the back of her tunic. He swung her over his head, chanting,
"Stupid O-Rant, stupid O-Rant, we heard you coming."
He changed the angle of the swing. Now her head came within inches of the ground, and then high above the Grawlig's massive skull. Pain roared within her head with every sweep. On the next downward swing, she fought darkness closing in around her. She lost. Hello, Hodor Hoarder. I did not read that right. Hodor Hoarder. How are you tonight? Chapter 2. Into the Mountain. Old leaves, moldy and partially decomposed, softened the ground beneath Kale. Her nose wrinkled against the musty smell. Her head felt like a cracked melon, and her eyes refused to open.
Bow, chicka, bow, wow.
Holy crap, that was a lot louder than I thought it would be. Okay, read that. Leia is awesome, 455. Thank you for the follow. I'm glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. I hope you continue to enjoy. And as always, welcome to the dork side. How are you doing tonight, Leia? Gonna turn that down just a little bit. And then I also need to make it so that you guys can see that when that happens. There we go. Okay. Hold on, let me test and see if it's a good, There we go, that's a bit better. That's not quite so loud. Okay. Book reading is fun. Absolutely, I fully agree. Enjoy books a lot, so reading it on stream is just another super enjoyable thing for me to do. Nope, that's not gonna work. Okay, that's just gonna hang there then. Okay. Her head felt like a cracked melon. Her eyes refused to open. Her stomach wanted to heave. The putrid smell of rotting garbage tormented her. She shifted, a hard lump pressed against her ribcage. The egg! The rock-hard egg was still intact. Kale tried to sit. Bindings around her wrists and ankles stopped her. Grawlig's! She remembered the huge hairy Grawlig's and their rowdy game. She felt again the helplessness of being tossed from one rough ogre to another. Terror sickened her. They hadn't killed her, but she felt that every muscle in her body had been stomped on. She slitted her eyes open and peered at her surroundings. Grawlig's light sprawled around a campfire. Beyond the light cast by burning logs, night shadows hid the forest. Two females turned spits, roasting what looked like a large deer. A group lounged almost in a pile under trees across the clearing. They made loud, rhythmic noises Kale assumed must be a song. No one seemed to be interested in the captive trussed up and lying under a bush. Two Grawlegs sat just a few feet away as if they'd been set to guard her. Even they ignored her. They picked over a knee-high pile of dirty mushrooms, popping them into their drooling mouths, smacking their lips as they chomped on the treats. Kale closed her eyes against the sight, hoping to protect her stomach. The repulsive smell of the Grawlegs could not be shut out so easily. To distract herself, she searched her memory for tales of the mountain ogres. What's true and what's fable? In the stories, they eat anything they catch. Lucky for me, it looks like they prefer roasted venison to roasted orant. Dumb and vicious. I think I can testify to that much. Afraid of tight places? Maybe. Clumsy with their fingers. Moving her head just enough to look down, Kale examined the cloth binding her hands together. She wiggled her wrists, and a loose knot unraveled. Well, they don't tie knots very well. She glanced up at her guards to see if they noticed her movements. They were still bent on stuffing the forest fungi past their flabby lips. Carefully, she moved her ankles apart an inch, and then back. Apart an inch, and then back and forth, until she could slip her bare feet out of the binding. Can I escape? She watched the two Grawlegs push dirt-encrusted mushrooms into their mouths. Their pile dwindled with every minute. Soon they would have nothing to distract them. Could she crawl away? Would they turn and catch her? Should she wait until the females declared the roasting deer done and pass the meat around? If I wait too long, I'll probably be dessert. Kale made her decision. Rolling onto her stomach, she crawled deeper into the bushes surrounding the camp. The Grawlegs caterwauling covered the crunch of leaves and twigs under her as she slithered away from the light. On the other side of low bushes, she found herself against boulders, part of the mountain looming over the smaller hills. She rose to her hands and knees and crept another 10 yards, then on her feet, but still nearly doubled over. She followed the jumble of rocks. Her muscles protested, but she pushed on. Distance muffled the noisy voices of her captors. Kale breathed more deeply, begging her body to relax. Surely, tension caused as much of her pain as the injuries inflicted by the Grawlegs. A shout went up from the camp, followed by a clamor of voices and howls from the angry brutes. Kale quickened her pace, looking over her shoulder, expecting to see dark, hairy shapes rising out of the forest to chase her. One misplaced foot slipped into a hole, and she found herself sliding, not away from the rocks and down the mountainside, but into a narrow opening under a huge boulder. She grabbed for roots to try and break her fall. Loose dirt rained down around her as she continued to scrabble, sliding 10 feet farther before landing on a hard rock floor. The impact jarred her aching body. She clenched her teeth and squeezed her eyes shut against the pain. Debris still showered on her head. Instinctively, she lifted her arms to cover her hair. The last trickle of dirt slowed and then settled. Kale relaxed her jaw and opened her eyes. Pitch dark surrounded her. She listened and heard the plink of dripping water somewhere behind her. She shivered. Goosebumps rose on her arms. Cold and frightened, she looked around for a means to escape. peering upward, she could make out the opening and the starry sky beyond. A cave. This may be good. Aren't Grawlocks afraid of closed-in places? I sure hope so. A scuffling warned her that the Grawlocks were trampling around in the forest above her. Maybe they'll just pass on by? She heard branches snap, grunts and low voices, and an excited exclamation. She'd been found. The heads of three ugly Grawlocks blocked out the dim light from above. They chanted,
"Stupid Orant, stupid Orant, we smelled you."
Kale slumped in a heap, clutching her knees and leaning against the cold rock wall. Too tired to think, too tired to fight despair, she allowed the tears to come.
"Stupid Orant, stupid Orant, we smelled you."
The chant grew louder as more tormentors joined the first three Grawlocks kneeling by the hole. A hairy arm reached down and groped along the sides of the rock. More dirt, leaves, and twigs fell on Kale's head. The young Orant girl curled tighter, shrinking from the voices above. Her hand searched for her treasure, pulling it out by the leather cord. She grasped the smooth cloth of the drawstring pouch. At first, the egg inside lay cold and unresponsive. Gradually, it grew warm. Kale concentrated on the soft thrum in her hand, blocking out the
"stupid Orant"
chant of the Grawlocks. Pain and fatigue.
Fatigue. That's a word.
Pain and fatigue, fear and panic, drained away. She shifted around to find a fairly comfortable position on the stony floor. With the pouch gripped in her hand and pressed against her cheek, she fell asleep. When she opened her eyes once more, streams of light shone into the cave at three spots. The first was directly above her. A head covered with matted brown hair lay partially inside the hole. Kale could see a large, hairless ear and part of the loose lips of the beast. Rough snores rumbled above. A beam, no more than a hand's width, descended from a second hole in the ceiling. The third opening, on the opposite side of the dismal cave, showed more promise. Not only was the hole big enough for Kale to wiggle through, but also large boulders, like uneven stair steps, made climbing possible. She stood and stumbled across the uneven cave floor. She looked up and studied the hole. she hoped to use for her escape. Since the ceiling of the cave sloped upward, it'd be a long climb compared to the slide of last night. "I'm thankful that's not the hole I fell through," she whispered. Tucking her treasure inside the neck of her blouse, she started climbing. She placed each foot carefully and tested each ledge before shifting her whole weight. She didn't want to cause a landslide for two reasons. "I don't want to wake those Grawlocks, and I don't want to be buried under a ton of boulders. I want to get out of here alive. I want to get to Vendela in one piece." Warm air touched her hand as she placed it on the next rock. Contrasted with the chill air surrounding her, it felt like a breath from the mouth of a huge animal. She pulled her hand back and listened. Faintly, she heard the coarse snores of Grawlocks and the morning chatter of birds in the trees outside. An odd combination. Within the cave, only the drip of water from a far corner reached her ears. Cautiously, she eased up to peer over the rock. A narrow passage stretched back into the darkness. Moist air flowed steadily from the opening. "I wonder what's back there." Again, she tilted her head and listened intently. No sound came through the tunnel opening. No sound at all. Curiosity niggled at her thoughts. What's in that tunnel? How far back does it go? Why warm air? She found herself crouched next to the hole and leaning in. She'd have to crawl on hands and knees. If she had a light of some sort, she could go in. She put a hand on the floor of the tunnel and placed her head within the opening. What am I doing? I don't want to go in there. I want to get away from the Grawlegs. She drew back as if she'd nearly stepped off a high cliff. Her breathing came in quick, panicked puffs. Clenching her fists, fighting the urge to plunge into the tunnel, she remembered Mistress Miger's stern face. Focus on what's ahead. Kale stretched a hand up and grabbed a rock ledge. In a minute, she'd be out of the cave. Still, she wanted to turn back and explore the tunnel. The powerful urge to go through that underground passage scared her. It made no sense. She climbed the last few feet to the top of the cave with firm determination. Kale cautiously poked her head and then her shoulders above the ground. Squinting in the bright morning sun, she considered the bushes around the rocks where she had fallen into the cave. Her present outlook was higher and a good 20 feet west of the sprawled Grawlegs. Not all of them had fallen asleep around the hole. That meant some were out of sight. Awake or asleep? And how many? As near as she could count, 11 uncouth Grawlegs lay in piles in and around the bushes. Last night, dozens of Grawlegs had gathered in the camp. Where are the others? She surveyed the surrounding area, first the low ground ahead. Then she turned and peered above her. The best route of escape lay over the rocks going west. At least, that looks like the best way. She looked again at the beasts below. The Grawlegs might sleep for some time. They had feasted late and probably guzzled Brillium, a brewed ale that none of the 7 high races could consume. 5, maybe 10 minutes, and I'll be in and out of that tunnel. She slipped back into the cave and into the stone burrow before she could think twice about what she planned to do. Thick, moist air settled on her skin as she groped her way in the dark. A sweet fragrance grew heavier as she moved farther and farther away from the cave. The dark, the smell, the damp, all screamed danger in her mind. Her arms and legs kept moving. She argued with herself, trying to force her body to back up and leave both the tunnel and the cave. None of her words, muttered softly in the cloying atmosphere, reached her ears. Enchantment, she realized with a groan. She could not resist whatever pulled her into depths of darkness. Trembling, she hoped fear would cause her to collapse. Then I'd stop. Then I couldn't go one bit further. But I probably couldn't scoot backwards either. I'd be stuck. Stuck until I die.
Hi, Carm. How you doing tonight? Sorry, I didn't want to stop in the middle of the chapter. There wasn't really a good paragraph stopping point. Sorry about that. Just had to cough. So, we kind of talked about Kale's egg. And I showed this off last time, but I don't know. I feel like I always, I'm always wanting to show off more, my egg more and more often. So give me just a second, and I'll show you guys my dragon egg. Thank you.
Okay, we're back. And it, yes, it is heist. Rather than raid. Because the raid command is for when we go out to someone else's channel. And that's a caster command only. But here we have my lovely dragon's egg. It's really cold right now. But this... I really like to have it around when I need to stop hitting the pop filter. I like having it around when I read these books. I don't know if you guys can hear the tapping. Like in the book, yeah. My mom was in the military. Grew up with her like that. And she was deployed over in Turkey. And she brought back these stone eggs. And I've always just thought of mine as a dragon's egg, and it's super smooth. It's really relaxing to play with. It doesn't give quite the tapping sound that I was hoping it would give, but that could also just be because my nails are super short. Sorry, Jacob. So, and it's really nice because, like in the book, after you've held it long enough, it does start to warm up. I just like to imagine that. Despite the fact that I've had it for years, that there's a little baby dragon inside of it. But it's also slightly discouraging because it means it won't come out for me, but I still like to pretend sometimes. That's my egg. I think I'm gonna actually have it sitting here with me. See if we can't warm it up a little bit. Wake the little baby dragon. So we're actually just gonna tuck it right here in my little jacket thing. I'm not gonna lie, that's kind of the reason I wore this jacket. It's because I planned to bring the egg out. And then, let me put its bed right over there. Oops. I want to get
eventually a really nice, like, wooden box, that I can line with, a little bit of foam and then, like, velvet. Or possibly satin. But I'm personally a big fan of velvet, the way fabric feels. And just make a little box, dragon egg box for my dragon egg. Maybe carve a dragon on the lid of it or something. But I don't personally have the skills for that, but, you know, it's still possible someday. Or maybe I can commission someone if I have enough money to. So, yeah, let's continue with the book. Chapter 3. Blue Cavern. Darkness and the tunnel pressed against Kale. Each time she tried to stop, her arms and legs ached to move forward. She bit back the whimper that rose to her lips. Whining never got me out of a lick of work as a village slave. It won't help here. Focus on what's ahead. Oh no. Somehow focusing on what's ahead doesn't seem the right thing to do. I don't want to follow Mistress Meger's wise advice. I mustn't give up. The things I learned in River Away are a part of me, and those things are good and strong and pure. What did she say? What did she say? Focus on what's ahead. Use what is behind. And there is always something from your past that will help you with your future. Use what is behind. Perhaps when she got to whatever this force pulled her, or to wherever this force pulled her, she would have a chance to defend herself. She tried to imagine herself swinging fists at some unseen force. Bali and Granmer often fought in the square of River Away, showing off their talent as fighting Marions. She tried to picture how they held their short, muscular bodies as they prepared to lunge at each other. Instead, she saw Mistress Avion's chicken coop. More enchantment. I can't even see in my mind what I want to see. She groaned again and hunched it down so that she was almost on her belly. She squirmed through the narrowing tunnel. The rough walls came closer together, and still she crept forward. The heavy smell of minerals choked her, and still she couldn't stop. Inch by inch, she moved into the darkness. I'm probably in the middle of this mountain by now. Her knees hurt from scraping over the uneven rock surface, and the tops of all 10 toes felt raw. Instead of slowing down, she moved faster. The enchantment grew stronger, urging her on. I hope there's no hungry beast waiting for me. I don't want to be somebody's breakfast. Her own stomach grumbled. Farmer Briggs' bread and cheese were at a distant memory. A soft, azure glow appeared ahead. She breathed a sigh of relief. The end of the tunnel. Whether it's good or bad, it's better than crawling through this tiny space, wandering and worrying. The bluish light continued to beckon. Excitement overcame the dread in her heart. The cramped passage abruptly opened up to a vast underground chamber. She twisted to pull her legs in front of her. As she hopped down into the cavern, she saw lights glistening from millions of tiny sapphire-like stones embedded in the rock walls. An additional glow emanated from icicle-like formations hanging from the ceiling and thrusting up from the floor. They look like sharp dragon's teeth. The bubbling of an underground hot spring distracted her for a moment. The steam that rose from a foamy surface smelled sweet, like syrup boiling in the spring after the trees had been tapped. The enchantment pulled her attention away from the odd formations in the cavern and she walked unerringly through the maze of pointed columns to a niche in the opposite wall. 7 small oval stones clustered together in a nest of hardened brewer. Dragon eggs! Her hand went automatically to the pouch hanging around her neck. Now I know why I saw Mistress Avion's chicken coop. This is too much like gathering eggs for breakfast to be real. Am I dreaming? She touched one of the glowing stones, felt its cool, rough surface, and saw the light turn part of her hand blue. I'm awake. She whipped the scarf from her neck and stretched it out on the floor. She picked up each egg and held it with wonder before placing it on the soft blue material. When she'd lined up all 7 eggs, she sank to the ground beside them, sitting cross-legged, admiring her find. 7! She breathed the word. She pulled out her treasure and opened the pouch. She placed the dragon egg she had been carrying next to the others. 8. I have 8 dragon eggs. Chief Councilman Miger had had a fit when he saw 1.
How did you find it, girl?
He'd asked. I went to the stream to gather rushes for Mistress Avion. I waded into the water and my skin began to tingle.
Tingle?
Yes, tingle.
Go on.
He placed his hands upon his ample hips and glared at her. Being a Marion, he didn't have much height, only a few more inches than Kale, but his ominous expression made the village slave feel small and vulnerable. She swallowed hard before continuing. I waded under the bent leaf trees to the boulders. The egg was in a hole there.
Where?
Under the water.
Under the water?
In the rocks. I reached in and pulled it out.
How did you know it was there?
I didn't.
Why did you stick your hand in a hole?
I don't know.
There could have been a blatig fish in there with sharp teeth ready to gobble your fingers.
Kale didn't have an answer. She didn't dare scoff at the fabled fish that ate children when they fell in the river. She hadn't believed that old wives' tale since she was old enough to gather reeds for basket making. Master Miger sat down hard on the bench by his front door.
There has to be a meeting,
he said with a moment of contempt after a moment of contemplation.
We must decide what to do with you.
May I keep the egg?
What?
May I keep the egg? It's mine, isn't it?
See how much you know? Nothing! No one owns a dragon egg.
Kale had been disappointed. Beside her clothes, she didn't have a thing that was her own. She told herself being allowed to keep the egg had been a small hope, and therefore losing what wasn't even hers had to be a small disappointment.
You can't stay here.
The councilman's words shocked Kale.
You have to go to Vendela, girl. But the village council will meet first.
He had stood and walked away, but more words drifted back to her as he shook his head and glowered at the ground.
Shocking! Never in the river away. Never this far south.
Kale looked at the blue scarf and the eggs nestled in its folds. She counted them again. In the pale light of the cavern, each shimmered a faint blue. In the sunlight, she thought they would be an alabaster white, like the egg from River Away. Her breath seized in concern as she spied her treasured egg. She picked it up and examined it more closely. The egg from River Away had tangles of fine dark lines cracked over the surface. The lines had not been there a month before. The council told me not to take it out of the pouch until I reached the hall in Vendela. Could I have broken it just by taking it out? I thought it was too hard to break. What happens if I did break it? What will the wizards of the hall do to a village girl who broke a dragon egg? She turned the egg over in her hand, hoping she would see some sign that this promise of a new life was not damaged. The dragon egg warmed and began its gentle thrum. Maybe it's just the light in here. She relaxed and enjoyed holding her treasure. After only a moment, her ease gave way to amazement. The weariness and aches that had overcome her body were vanishing. The hunger squeezing her middle was gone as well. Her eyes opened wide, and she watched as the small scrapes and scratches on her bloody toes and nails healed over. The damage to her body disappeared as if it had never been, but the torn cloth of her trousers was as ragged as ever. When the last break in her skin closed, she stared at the egg in her hand as if she had never seen it before. If her clothes hadn't been tattered and bloody, she would have thought she'd dreamed the injuries. As her excitement grew, the egg jumped. She tightened her grip to keep it from falling. "I guess you aren't broken," she said with a grin. She tucked the egg back in its pouch and pushed the bag inside her shirt. She moved the other eggs onto the rock and tied a knot in the scarf about a foot from one end. She tucked one egg in next to that knot, folded the soft cloth around it. Using a length of thread from the unraveling edge of her tunic, she secured the egg and tied a knot. She placed another egg on her makeshift sling and tied it in. When she finished, she had a rope-like object with 7 bulges. She tied the egg-bearing blue scarf around her waist, next to her skin, under the tunic and shirt. "Now, let's get out of here." She stood and trotted across the floor of the cavern, neatly dodging around the glowing columns. Just as she reached the opening of the tunnel, she had a thought. She turned to search the area around her. Spying a fist-sized rock lying on the ground, she rushed to pick it up. Dozens of crystals shimmered from the rough stone. She smiled and carried it into the dark tunnel. The way back didn't seem nearly as long. The enchantment which had pulled her in had disappeared when she touched the first egg. No dread of what was ahead plagued her thoughts. The rock glowed in the tunnel. She could see several feet ahead of her, although it was awkward to hold the rock and crawl. She pushed on, eager to get to the cave and climb out the top. The thought of the Grawling's awakening helped her to hurry. She halted as soon as her head poked through the opening from the tunnel to the dimly lit cave. 3 beams of light still fell in straight shafts from the outside. They'd shifted with the movement of the sun. Her ears told her something else had changed. She tilted her head, trying to identify the clamor. The Grawlings no longer snored. Instead, she heard metal clanging against metal, angry shouts, frenzied commands, and roars of fury. If she was not mistaken, sounds of battle echoed from all 3 openings of the cave.
Noodling for catfish? What do you mean, Jacob? Also, sometimes I wonder if I'm broken.
I fully understand that feel. I really do, man. It's a sucky feel, but I fully understand it.
Okay, before we go on to the next chapter, I am going to take a quick break and run to the bathroom. Possibly grab a snack, because I'm kind of hungry. But we will be right back in just a couple minutes. So I'll let you guys enjoy the background sound, as well as wonderful art of my dear friend Lady Static. And I'll be right back, guys.
Okay, I'm back. Oops, I clicked the wrong thing. One second. There we go. Sorry about that. Okay. There we go. Okay. I'm sorry you're hungry. Get a snack. Snacks are good. I got myself a little bar. It's a vanilla Greek yogurt granola bar. I know some people like the sounds of rappers. Noodling is a way to catch catfish where you stick your arm in a muddy hole and wait for a catfish to clamp onto your arm, then you pull it out. She put her hand in a hole and could have been bitten by a fish. Okay. Apparently, I guess. Although, the fish in question, it sounded like it was a horror story told to young children to keep them from wandering into the waters. But yeah, that sounds like it's the basic idea. She was noodling for child-eating fish and got a dragon egg instead. I think she got the good end of the deal. I did also get myself two clementines that I'll probably snack on a little bit later. There we go. Okay. That was really loud. Sorry. Oh, I'm sorry, Jacob. I would share with you if I could. I would absolutely share if I could. So when my dad got these granola bars, he got the wrong ones. These vanilla Greek yogurt ones. The right ones are like it's got like triple berry or something like that. But he ordered these instead, and these aren't as good. But I tell myself that they're like eating Rice Krispie Treats with a bit of vanilla flavoring thrown in. Because that's kind of what they taste like. It tastes like vanilla Rice Krispie Treats almost. So. So usually, I'm a bit weird about eating sounds. I try to, not chew too close to the mic. But I do know that a lot of people, get ASMR from eating sounds. So I'm trying to get over my weird factor, I guess, and be alright with it. Pretty much just on comfy corner. Other times I'm just like, yeah, I'm not gonna. But, it's still weird for me, but, you know, if it helps people relax and experience ASMR, you know, more power to them, I guess, so. Like hearing people eating potato chips. I don't know if I have any in my house. I think they might have been eaten already. The first crunch especially. I get that. I think for me, one of my big issues with the eating sounds is my dad is a very noisy eater, and it's kind of gross. Just the way that he eats or whatever, it just sounds kind of gross. So. And for some reason, because of that, I'm a little bit, I'm not as much a fan of the eating sounds in ASMR videos. So I'm probably just gonna snack on the clementine while I'm reading, both as a way to kind of help me not be too hungry, but then also it'll help with my how dry my mouth gets, and I won't need to take breaks to take a drink. I can just pop a clementine slice in. I guess it's still taking a break, but I could send you recordings of me playing didgeridoo. That could be interesting. For like breaks or the opening or closing. That might be cool, Jacob. I really like the changing, the sound generator that I have, that I use, and just the way that it changes throughout, and then I can pick different generators. But if I had, like with the didgeridoo for the breaks, or when I'm first starting out, or when I'm closing out for the night. Bit tartar than I thought it would be. Okay. Also, by the way, we made it past chapter 3. Yay! And actually, it was chapter 2 where I'd ended last time. or when I did the preview. So, this is even better. Okay. Chapter 4. Friend or foe? This time, Kale raised her head out of the hole, even more cautiously. Judging from the tumult, she'd expected an army to be facing the Grawlegs. Kale spotted only 3 attackers, 2 mounted on dragons. Most of the noise came from the mountain ogres. The 3rd attacker stood within a circle of the Grawlegs and felled them right and left, wielding a sling-type weapon with a spiked ball at the end. She recognized him as a fighting Marion, like the race of people populating River Away. His muscled frame, short and block-like, stood solid against the onslaught. Known as farmers and fighters, the Marions could make any ground productive and defend any ground against invaders. The dragons in the air were not as big as the greater dragons Kale had seen fly into the city. One large, milky-white beast carried a giant warrior in armor and chainmail. As the dragon swooped and soared over the battling Grawlegs, the rider hurled lances with deadly aim. The insignia of a royal house emblazoned his helmet and riding gear. 2 large quivers hung over the dragon's shoulders, just in front of the knight's knees. Kale watched the other dragon's aerobatics, stunned by her beauty. The red wings glistened as if covered with tiny rubies. Her chest and stomach pulsated in blue and purple shimmers. Sunlight reflected off blue-green scales on her head, tail, and hind feet. A small, furry rider wore bright colors, almost as flamboyant as his mount. Shouting terse words Kale could not understand, the man cast yard-long lances among the Grawlegs. "I am Leetoo Benz. We come to rescue you." A female voice uttered the words directly into Kale's thoughts. The Orant girl jerked in surprise. "A mind speaker?" She looked around, trying to decide who had spoken. "Go now, while we have the Grawlegs' attention. Go west, over the ridge. Follow the stream down the mountainside. We'll catch up with you." Kale still held the glittering rock she'd picked up in the cavern. She opened the neck of her shirt and dropped the stone under the frayed material. It settled against the bulge of dragon eggs tied to her waist. She pressed her palms into the rim of the hole and hoisted herself over the edge. Without stopping to watch the combat, she scrambled over the rocky terrain away from the fighting. A battle cry rent the air. Kale turned to see the rider of the smaller dragon slide off his saddle into a knot of Grawlegs. "He fell." The miniature warrior, dressed in vibrant shades of green and gold, disappeared into the snarling melee of brown and black beasts. Kale imagined the little man ripped in pieces as the ogres tore at his arms and legs. She ran toward the clutch of tangled fighters until she stood on an outcropping just above. The Grawlegs made hideous noises. Dust rose, obscuring her view of the valiant little warrior. She saw flashes of color from his clothing, but not the man, nor how he defended himself. "They're killing him. I've got to do something." Kale picked up a rock and hurled it. It bounced off a Grawleg head. He grunted and swayed, but returned to his efforts to pummel the enemy in their midst without even looking up to see what had hit him. Kale threw one rock after another as fast as she could pick them up and as hard as her muscles would allow. "What are you doing? Get out of there! Don knows how to fight. He doesn't need you. Go! Quickly! Before they turn on you!" Kale hesitated. "Go!" She heaved the rock in her hand and took off toward the crest of the ridge. I don't like this. Not one bit. In River Away, everyone always yelled at me, go, come, do this, do that. But at least I knew who was ordering me about. At the top of her climb, she paused to look over her shoulder. Fierce fighting still raged in the gully below. She didn't want to be chastised again, so she turned away from the battle and stomped over the ridge. A stream sprang out of the rocks in the midst of a corpse of... In the midst of a copse of evergreen shrubs. Kale followed it easily. The noise of enraged Grawlugs battling her rescuers soon faded. The breeze whispered through the trees, cooling her as she trudged along. The sun sparkled off the brook as it formed over its rounded rock bed. Birds sang in the forest, as if nothing so ugly as raiding Grawlugs existed in the whole of Amara. She marched along, muttering about Grawlugs and voiceless orders and not knowing where she was going. As she tramped beside the stream, her anger faded. A yawn stretched her mouth. Her eyes drooped. Then her legs grew rubbery, making it hard to stay upright. She stumbled more than once over terrain that should have been easy for her to cover. Jumbled thoughts broke her concentration, and she kept losing her balance. She said they came to rescue me. Who are they? How did they know I was in trouble? How did they know where I was? Could Farmer Briggs somehow have known? No, how could he? I'm so tired, and I'm getting hungry. How long before they catch up to me? What if they lost that fight with the Grawlugs and the Grawlugs catch up with me instead? What if... I'm so tired. My whole body hurts. Kale sank down on the mossy bank. I'll just rest a minute. She pulled the pouch from beneath her shirt, and soon fell fast asleep with it tucked under her cheek. The whistling first sounded like a double-crested mountain finch, but then a few too many high notes warbled at the end of the call. Kale's eyes sprang open and she sat up. A dawn eel sat up a log by the stream. From his finger, a string danced over the edge of the rock into the water. His clothes were tattered, but bright in hue between the smudges of dirt and blood. His whistle changed the song of a speckled thrush. Kale compared the look of this real-life dawn eel to the painted figure in the mural at the River Away Tavern. This whistling Donniel sat, but she was sure if he stood, his little frame would not reach 4 feet. His tan and white furry head sat on a well-proportioned body. His large eyes hid under shaggy eyebrows that drooped down his temples and mingled with a long mustache. His broad nose stuck out like a muzzle of a dog, and his black lips met with hardly a chin at all underneath. Dressed in which rich fabric of glorious colors, he was far more interesting than the blurry image of the dark tavern wall. All right, Jacob, have a safe trip home. Thank you for hanging out with us for a while, at least. Hopefully, if we don't see you again tonight, hopefully we'll hang out with you at a later date. Once again, I hope you have a safe journey home. Also, yay for work being done.
Hungry?
He asked. Smiling, his face became round. Half of it the huge mouth. 2 ears covered with soft fur perched on the top of his head, near the front. They twitched and turned as he listened.
Only a little.
She had never talked to a Donniel. Only Marion's and a few Kimmins came to River Away. Kimmins were smaller than Donniels, but their bodies were much more delicate, almost wispy-looking. They wore forest colors in loose, draping material. And a Kimmins' face had what Kale thought was a more normal set of eyes, ears, nose, and mouth. Although she had to admit, she thought their raggedy haircuts and lack of eyebrows made them look perpetually surprised. You are very hungry, said the Donnell. His voice rumbled a bit over the words.
I am?
Yes. He nodded decisively. When was the last time you ate?
Kale remembered the bread and cheese Farmer Brig had shared. Yesterday noon.
He jerked on his line and pulled out a brook dabbler. Its scales silver on the belly, its back coal black, its fins the colors of the sunset. You've been battered by Grawlegs, continued the fisherman as soon as he had his catch off the hook. You fell down in a cave and healed yourself using magic.
I did?
The Donnell cast her a skeptical glance. You did.
Magic?
The egg.
Oh.
Kale put her hand on the pouch. How much did this odd little man know about the dragon egg? All the questions that had disconcerted her as she followed the stream came back. What if this Donnell meant to steal the egg? Did he also know about her new find? Surely, 8 dragon eggs would be very valuable. How did he even know about the first? She hadn't told a soul since leaving River Away. The Donnell stood and brushed off his torn and dirty pants.
My name is Dar.
Kale stood as she had been taught.
I'm Kale.
Again, the Donnell's smile almost overcame his entire face.
Pleased to meet you.
He crossed to a path left on the ground and pulled out a cloth-wrapped bundle. Untying it, he revealed some flattened rolls. He handed them to Kale.
Eat. The magic makes you think you aren't hungry, but your body needs nourishment, especially when it's been repairing bruises and scrapes.
Kale took the offering and sat again, this time beneath a boiling tree. Dar gathered sticks and laid a fire while she ate. Kale watched him with suspicion. He whistled and hummed and didn't seem to mind her silence. Kale had never been much of a talker. Slaves weren't encouraged to enter into conversations. But the questions boiled inside her, and she thought she'd scream if she didn't get at least some of the answers.
Where did you come from?
Dar crouched beside a pile of sticks he arranged with great precision.
The hall.
And why did you come to help me? How did you know I was in trouble?
Actually, I didn't know, but Merlander did.
Who's Merlander?
Oh. Who's Merlander? The words came out louder than she'd expected, and she cringed. None of the villagers would have forgiven such an outburst. Dar seemed unconcerned.
My dragon.
The beautiful one?
Dar grinned again.
She is something to look at, isn't she? But vain. Don't say too much about her being pretty when she's around.
Kale nodded, agreeing to his request as if she understood all the intricacies of owning a dragon.
You said my dragon. I was told that no one could own a dragon.
Oh, I don't own Merlander. I say my dragon in the same way I would say my friend, or my sister. She would say my Donnell. We've been together 5 years.
Kale gulped and almost choked on the bread. Dar came over and slapped her on the back. When she was breathing easily again, he got a heavy ceramic mug out of his pack and brought her cool water from the stream.
She talks? Your dragon talks?
No, not like you and I. She knows my thoughts, and I know hers. She told me a new dragon was coming from the east, over the Morchain Mountains. As you carried the egg closer, Merlander knew that you were tired, or excited, or frightened. The dragon embryo in your egg already reflects your disposition. My dragon knew what your dragon felt. When you were terrorized by the Grawlegs, we knew. But we couldn't come to you when you were unconscious. We had no beacon. Then you were awake and hurting. We knew. But after a short while, you went to sleep.
You knew all this?
Merlander knew.
Dar lit the fire and cleaned the fish. He hung the brook dabbler on a metal brace he plucked out of his pack and placed over the fire. Kale puzzled over all the information Dar had given her.
Councilman Miger was right. She didn't know anything.
So, she asked of Daniel as he slowly turned the cooking fish, will you take me to the hall now?
No, said Dar. I was sent to keep you from going to the hall.
Chapter 5. New Friends, New Enemies. Kale stood in a panic. This little Daniel was not what he seemed. Where could she run? She'd been told where to go by the elders of the village. To Vendella. She must follow their instructions. Should she go to the Goose and the Gander and look for May? That was what Farmer Brigg had advised. Always before, she had only to listen to instructions and do what she was told. Nothing complicated ever came her way.
Maybe being a slave isn't so bad. If I can just get to the hall, I'll be a servant. That's enough like being a slave, that all this adventure with Grawligs and Donniels, running from danger and battles, will just cease to exist.
She looked at Dar and his diminutive frame. His short legs would never keep up with her. She surveyed the forest and wondered which way to run. A hailing cry came from the sky. Putting a hand at her brow to shield against the sun, Kale scrunched up her eyes and saw Merlander with her beautiful red wings swooping down. Again, the dragon called with a round, melodious tone. Dar waved a greeting. The whoosh of the last beat of Merlander's wings ruffled Kale's hair like a spring breeze. The dragon folded her wings against her sides. A young woman riding the dragon's back threw her leg over the arching blue neck and slid down glittering scales to the ground.
I am Li Tu Benz,
she announced with a nod in Kale's direction. She turned to a scowl on the Daniel.
Dar, what did you say to her?
Mudgets, 790, thank you for the follow. Glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. I hope you continue to enjoy. And welcome to the dork side. How are you doing tonight, Mudgets? Sorry, I wasn't able to read your, to read your name, so I had to lean forward for that. Okay. Dar, what did you say to her? And before he could answer, what foolishness, how clumsy.
Dar dipped his head, hiding his expression. His ears drooped.
I'm sorry, Li Tu said to Kale. Dar teases, among other disreputable things. Think of him as an older brother who has no sense of decorum, or no sense, period. Paladin has urgent need of your skill. That is why you must turn aside and leave going to the hall until later.
Kale stood rigid at her in her confession. Wow, I can words. Kale stood rigid in her confusion. This was the commanding voice she had heard as the Grawligs battled, the one who said they had come to rescue her. Kale looked back to the repentant Daniel, and then to the self-assured young Emerlindian. She did wear the colors of the hall. Her tunic was a mellow, golden tan of ripe wheat, and her breeches the rich brown of the earth. But how could Kale know for sure who Dar and Li Tu were? What did they really want? Were they here to help or hinder her? Li Tu Benz came up only to Kale's shoulder, yet she had a dominant presence. White, blonde, and blue-eyed in a slim frame, Li Tu did not look a bit delicate, but rather tight, tautly muscled, ready to spring into action. She was a young Emerlindian. Chin, nose, eyebrows, and ears all slightly pointed, her beauty was sharp, drawn with clean lines.
Kale had heard stories of Merlindians. The race was born almost pure white. As they aged, their skin, hair, and eyes darkened. They lived a long time, hundreds of years. Wise brown grannies were both male and female, and cherished by the younger generations. But even older than grannies were a few black grands, Immerlindians who supposedly neared 1,000 years in age. Generally thought to be noble, kind, and benevolent, the Immerlindians possessed interesting mental powers. That's part of the idea, Tom Cruise. Here, let me, this is the book that we're reading. And then, this is the idea behind the stream itself. Okay. Kale winced at the knowledge. This Leetu bends, reads my thoughts. She knows I don't trust her. Kale cast her eyes down to the forest floor, concentrating on the leaves scattered at her feet. Is it possible to block her reading my mind? Leetu laughed. Yes, it is. And it's a technique I'll teach you as part of your training. For now, you can't throw up a barrier. Kale looked up. Merlander had settled, lying down at the edge of the clearing. Dar stood behind her neck, his head just coming to her glistening cheek. He leaned against her comfortably, as if welcoming her back. Kale could feel the peace between them. Leetu Benz had not moved. Her bright face, radiating warmth and friendliness, no longer held the stern and autocratic look she had given Dar when she first arrived. Kale wanted to like her. Big Eyes Queso, Big Eyes Queso, thank you for the follow. I'm glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. I hope you continue to enjoy. And as always, welcome to the dork side. How are you doing tonight, Queso? Okay. Could she put her trust in these two? The elders had told her to go to the hall. Did she dare put aside Councilman Miger's instructions? Why would Dar want to keep her from going where she was supposed to go? Leetu said Paladin needed her skill. What skill? Kale let herself collapse in a rather undignified heap on the ground. I know it's overwhelming, said Leetu. The Immerlindian's comment did little to ease Kale's mental struggle. Since she'd left Farmer Briggs' wagon, nothing has gone as she'd expected. Life was much simpler in River Away, where Mistress Miger told Kale whose house to go to, and the mistress of that home ordered her about for all day. Yeah, it's really enjoyable, Tom Cruise. It's nice because it's relaxing for me as well. So, if I can help other people relax and fall asleep or just chill, and then on top of that, relax myself. Yes, it's just wonderful. Mr. Bolo, you're breaking the mood. How are you tonight, Mr. B? Okay. Leetu came and sat beside her. Try to relax. Let's take care of you. Let us take care of you. Dar's a good cook, when he doesn't get distracted and burn everything. The Donnie jerked to attention, rushed back to the fire, and turned to the fish. Leetu grinned and returned to her quiet talk with Kale. Her low, reasonable voice soothed Kale's anxiety. You do need food. You've been relying on magic to sustain you, and it won't, you know. Well, you wouldn't know that yet, but you'll learn. Your skill is in finding dragon eggs, and there's an egg that must be found. Vitu pulled a green parnot fruit from the pouch at her hip and handed it to Kale. We'll eat and talk, she said. You can ask us as many questions as you like, and then we'll start off on our quest. See, I'm doing well. Playing some Mad Max to keep myself awake while I watch. Awesome, Mr. B. No dozing off for Mr. Bolo. Doing a coding assignment. I'm liking this more than Pandora.
Aw.
Well, thank you, Mudguts. I appreciate that. I'm glad this is helping you as background noise for your coding. I've never been able to understand coding. It confuses the crap out of me. I have so much respect for people that get it. Boo Python? What about Python? I'm confused. Okay. It sounded so rational, and yet, it didn't. Oh, it's a coding language. Oh. I was not aware of that. That's cool. But not if you're booing it. I'm guessing it's a difficult one. Or if not difficult, then boring or something. Something's wrong with it that you're booing it. It sounded so rational, and yet it didn't. Tom Cruise Rage, thank you for the follow. Glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. Hope you continue to enjoy, and welcome to the dork side. That was louder than I anticipated it being. But welcome, 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 welcome. Okay, let's see if I can finish this sentence this time. It sounded so rational, and yet it didn't. Kale bit into the sweet fruit. The elders had given her instructions to go to the hall, but the elders were far away. Kale had enough experience to know what ignoring what you were told to do often led to trouble. She trusted the elders, for although they had never acted as parents to her, they had treated her fairly. They saw to it that she had food, something to wear, and schooling, such as it was. They allowed no villager to take advantage and work her too hard. She was free now. Well, sort of. She still had to go where she'd been told to go, and when she got to the hall, she would probably still have to do what she was told to do. But it was different somehow. Being a servant was better than being a slave, wasn't it? See, I saw ASMR and wanted to ask a question. How many people do you all know get really bad headaches from ASMR? I don't think... I know I've never experienced that. I don't think I've ever heard of it with the people I know that watch the videos and such. Oops, excuse me. Hey, DT! Yes, this book. Dragonspell. Did I share this book with you in college? I feel like I might have, because I know I had it with me. But yes. If I shared it with you, then you know how good a book it is. I'm sure I at least showed you. I remember reading it. You let me borrow. Okay, I thought so. It is a fantastic book, DT. Also, welcome. How are you tonight?
But yeah, crowd. I don't think I've personally talked with anyone that gets had headaches from ASMR. But yeah, I'm actually planning to read the entire series on stream, DT, assuming people want to hear the rest of the series. I'm hoping they will, because it's a very good one, so. Okay. Doing alright tonight for the most part. I'm doing pretty good. I had to go into work earlier. Today because, the normal Wednesday prep chef, was sick. So I got called in on my day off to work, but other than that, doing pretty good. Thank you, Forgotten Crowd. I hope you're able to figure out what's causing that, because that does not sound enjoyable. Like, I love ASMR. I love, watching videos and, getting the tingles, and just the relaxation that comes from it. I imagine that would be really upsetting to get headaches from something that's supposed to be relaxing. But hopefully you can figure out what's causing it and see if you can find another relaxation form. Or figure out how to make it work for you. Just can't stand it and it puts on edge. That's understandable. I can see how it would put you on edge, especially if it causes headaches. So I really need to change the coloring on this so that I can actually read what it says. Raw DCF, thank you for the follow. I'm glad you're enjoying the stream thus far, and I hope you continue to enjoy it, and welcome to the dork side. How you doing tonight, Raw? ASMR can cause headaches. Bejeweled 3 uses it and has a disclaimer for it. Oh. I was not aware of that. I did not know that, DT. You have a nice day as well, Forgotten Crowd. Doing great? Glad to hear it. Definitely glad to hear it. I might have to look into that, DT. Excuse me. But yeah, I hadn't heard of that before. So I might definitely have to do some research on that. Because that's, I'm really enjoying ASMR type stuff and just learning more about it. I like learning more about things like that. You could read the phone book for all I care. Just, aw, thank you, Tom Cruise. I watch a lot of ASMR videos on YouTube. Haven't seen a lot of ASMR on Twitch yet. Yeah, me neither. I've seen a couple people that supposedly do ASMR, but I haven't gotten to see any other streams or anything. They didn't have any VODs, so, but yeah, I thought I'd give it a shot, because I definitely enjoy Twitch a lot. I do want to kind of, eventually do solely YouTube videos, but I really wanted to have a Twitch stream night where I had these nice calming streams where I can do a little bit of ASMR and book reading. So, oops, it's easier for me to try things out when I have people that I can communicate with and give me ideas and that sort of thing. So, hi Cube, how are you? Yeah, I do ASMR on Wednesdays.
for my comfy corner stream. It's kind of ASMR, kind of book reading. It kind of depends. Like, my preferred ASMR is whisper. Is what I really like hearing. What relaxes me most are whisper videos. Or videos with no talking, just trigger sounds. A lot of the times I'll do book reading, and I like doing voices for books. So I have to do that soft spoken because rather than whisper, because doing voices at a whisper. I did it a bit for Tale of Despero, but it kind of strained my voice a little bit. Aw, cute. That's super sweet of you. I also have been uploading these up on YouTube because they do books. They're books, and I want people to be able to get the entire book, whether they fall asleep or if they miss a stream or they come in late or something like that. I like mouth sounds. Still don't know why it triggers me hardcore. So, like, what would constitute as mouth sounds? I haven't, I don't have a lot of research in ASMR besides the videos that I watch. So I'm not sure exactly what mouth sounds entail. Is that like that kind of thing? Or I'm not sure. I'll have to look into it. I'll definitely have to look into that for sure. Had to look up ASMR. Alternately. There you go. I have a very long bot command. Hi, Umbreon. Hi, baby. Welcome back. This is the first ASMR stream I've seen. I'm very okay with it. Oh, yay. I'm happy. It took me a while to talk myself into doing it, but... Hey, Kipasa. Mouth sounds can be, like, inaudible whispering. Kind of like lip-smacking, kissing sounds. Yeah, Cube, if you could send me a link to your favorite, that would, definitely help me learn. I'm trying to learn as much as I can. So, thank you for teaching me return. Aww. Hey, Danny, how are you tonight? Music makes me feel like that. Yeah, some people definitely experience ASMR from music.
Oh my gosh.
Excuse me. My allergies, though. Awesome. I'm gonna click that, and then I'm gonna pause it. Pause. My bot does time out. It does. So, whispering works. Okay, so I've got that paused. I will watch that after the stream. Good. Kind of a sleeping, kind of awake listening. Well, sleep is good, so hopefully we can help you doze off, Danny. We can read your whispers. Yeah. And that's fine. Jellybean is great with ASMR. Is that who? Is that video? Jelly. Oh, I don't think I've heard of this ASMR artist before. Awesome, a new one to learn and follow and listen. Ooh, she does pop rocks. Looks like she does a lot of eating sound things too. Oh wait, or is that? Yeah, that's her. Huh. Interesting.
definitely, look into her more. Oh, me too, Tom Cruise. It's like I can't breathe. All right, Narcan. Dimitri from Massage ASMR is another great ASMR artist. It's about time to wake up. Oh, fair enough, Danny. Fair enough. Ooh, an Australian accent. That does sound super calming, raw. K-pop stuff in her, on her normal channel. I don't follow her normal channel, but her ASMR. My favorite ASMR artist, I really like ASMR requests. Her name's Allie. I really like a lot of her videos. Ephemeral Rift. I enjoy his videos a lot. Some of his roleplay ones are a little bit too weird for me. But he's very good at triggers and everything. He's fantastic. I love Ephemeral Rift. And then I also, the first one that I got into, alright DT, sleep well, hope you're able to doze off, I hope you have a great night, send me a message if you need to chat about anything, or if you just want to hang out. I need someone to play games with or something, at some point in time. Roleplays are always goofy. I'm very picky about roleplays. Some of them kind of give me heebie-jeebies. They're just a little bit too much. Well, Umbreon, how did you cut yourself? I am not Canadian, no. Alright, Cube. Sleep well. Hope you have a great night. Thanks for stopping by. Like I said, I'm really weird about the roleplay ASMRs. Some of them I enjoy. I like post-apocalyptic ones. But for the most part, I prefer ones that aren't roleplay. Ephemeral Rift does a lot of roleplay ones, and a lot of his I'm okay with. Some of them are just a little too weird for me and I can't. But he has a couple that I really enjoy. But my current favorite ASMR post-apocalyptic, like Living in the Zombie Apocalypse, or there's this one girl that does, I can't remember her name or the name of the video, and I feel terrible, but she does, like, where you're a robot in kind of, like, it's kind of like an apocalyptic world or something, but she's, like, repairing you or whatever. I like those. I like the post-apocalypse ones. I've always been a big fan of steampunk and post-apocalypse. So, those are pretty enjoyable. Raviolis are just, ow. I'm sorry, Umbreon. I'm trying to think of something that... Can you do, like, yogurt or something? Like, something soft where you don't have to chew? So like yogurt or applesauce or something along those lines. I don't know much about this ASMR business. I just know I love these forehead tingles. I have headphones on. Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, raw. One sec. Let me permit you. Oops, there we go. But
But yeah, my absolute favorite ASMR video currently, ooh, this looks cool, is by Gentle Whispering. She's Russian. And so that accent is in there. But she has one where, if you're new to my channel, you don't know, I'm big into fiber arts. I like needle felting. I do that on Fridays. I do a Fiber Friday stream where usually, I'm needle felting, but I do want to start bringing in like sewing and such to those streams. And I'm really big into fabrics. I describe everything, basically I link it in my mind to how fabric feels. I'm an empath, so I'm able to like kind of gauge people's emotions. I feed off of people's emotions, and my emotions kind of depend on the other people's emotions. That's kind of empathy in a really condensed nutshell. But I've always kind of described it as, like, I can, when someone is acting happy, I can tell whether they're really happy or if they're just pretending, because when they're pretending, it feels like polyester rubbing against my skin as opposed to silk rubbing against my skin, and that's the only way I can describe it in my mind. So it's no, not polyester. Yeah, polyester's right. Where it looks like silk, it's shiny and looks like it could be silk, but it feels completely wrong. Polyester doesn't feel like the right word. I can't remember the right word. But yeah. So this Gentle Whispering has a ASMR video where she whispers, and she goes over, I think, 8 different fabrics, and just makes noises with the fabrics, and it's wonderful. Yes, Connor. Hi. Hi. Hi, Connor. How are you, Connor? Hi, Connor. 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 Hi. Alright. Hi, Connor. I'm good. Glad. I'm glad. Goldfish racing is interesting. Need to marry who, Narcan? I'm pretty good, Connor. I've gotten into chapter 4 or 5 in my book. Oh, yes. She's wonderful. Thank you for the host, Connor. I appreciate that support and you sharing me with your viewers and followers. I appreciate that a lot. Alright, we better get back to the book. Goldfish racing is hardcore. I have my mic pressed right up against my pop filter. That's not gonna help it work right. I was terrible. Aw, I'm sorry, Connor. Alright. Let's get on here. Okay. Could not blow Bill Clinton in the Oval Office fast enough. What? Leetoo Benz had said she could ask as many questions as she wanted. In River Way, she had never been encouraged to ask questions. That much was different, at least. But a problem remained. Would she know what questions to ask?
The small party ate without much conversation. Dar finished first and took out a foot-long metal harmonica. He settled against the tree trunk and began to play quiet tunes. "Digestive music," said Litu. "Dorniel's believe strongly in the correct type of music to accompany each of their activities." Kale nodded and continued to eat the delectable fish. Pretending to concentrate on her meal gave her an opportunity to think over just what she wanted to know. After each thought... After each thought, Kale examined Leetu's face for some indication that the Immerlindian knew what was going through Kale's mind. Her stomach knotted. She put her dinner aside. Nothing inside her head made any sense. I never had such big things to worry about in River Away. Is this what I really want? To be surrounded by people I don't know? Who might be friends or might be foes? Her companion set to doing chores, with a few dishes washed and stacked on a canvas pack. Litu and Dar sat down on either side of Kale. Her thoughts still jumbled every which way, but she couldn't stall any longer. "You must ask your questions," said Litu. She gestured with a graceful hand at the three gathered around the doused campfire. "We must be on our way." Kale looked to the dragon laden with bundles of supplies. "Where are we going?" "First, to find Wizard Fenworth." Kale didn't know one wizard from another. Weren't there wizards enough at the hall? "Why?" she asked. "He has been chosen to take care of the dragon egg once you have found it." "How do you know I can find it?"
"You have the gift," said Dar. "Didn't you walk right to the egg you carry in the pouch? Didn't you put your hand on it before you even knew what you were reaching?"
Kale's hands clenched on the edge of her tunic. It wasn't fair that they should know so much about her and be confident in all they did. She didn't know anything.
"How do you know about me?"
Litu slapped her hands on her knees and shook her head. "Paladin knew. We can't tell you how Paladin knows things. He just does." Kale blinked at Litu's agitation. But having been given permission to ask questions, she just couldn't keep from asking another.
"Why am I the one Paladin has chosen to look for this egg?"
Litu stood and paced.
"Another question that we cannot answer. Once you have been born in his service, once you have been in his service for a while, it will cease to amaze you that he knows so much."
Litu looked away for a minute, as if to summon up words to make it easier on Kale. She sighed her frustration and turned back to her listener.
"Let me tell you about the egg, and why it is so important."
Kale nodded.
"First, it's a meech egg."
"Meech?"
Dar jumped in.
"The highest order of dragon, the most powerful. A female meech may lay 3 eggs in her entire lifespan, over 500 years. The eggs are rare."
Litu put up her hand to stop Dar's lecture.
"This egg was taken by Risto."
"Who?"
Dar squirmed with his lips pressed firmly together as his eyes darted from Litu's face to Kale's. He just couldn't keep quiet and burst out with the information Kale needed.
"An evil wizard! Risto's an evil wizard!"
Litu cut him off with a look.
"Risto does not wish to hatch the egg, but to use the power of the egg to catch a grandiose spell."
"Of course," said Dar.
His ears twitched and he licked his lips as he stared at Kale.
"His spells are evil."
Little Doniel's eyebrows came together in a fierce frown.
"If he needs the power of a meech egg to get it done, there's no telling what contemptible transgression he's plotting."
"You mean you don't know what evil spell he's going to cast? How can you be so sure it's dangerous?"
Dar bounced to his feet, flinging his arms wide.
Because it's Risto. He doesn't do good things. He has all the evil traits that taint the seven high races. Pride, greed, deceit, faithlessness.
Dar sputtered in his outrage.
He's cruel, power mad, cunning.
He's evil. Litu interrupted. In the use of power from an unhatched egg, Risto will destroy the life within. Sorry, thought I was gonna sneeze, but apparently not.
You see?
Nope, wrong.
You see?
Said Dar, stamping his foot for emphasis.
Evil. No respect for Walder's handiwork. Risto must be stopped. And Paladin sent us to do it.
With Fenwath. Lisa reminded the Doniel. Dar screwed his face into a grimace of disgust.
Having that wizard along will lead to disaster.
Why? Asked the Kale. Litu sent Dar a warning look before answering. It's best you wait and see, Kale. Oh, excuse me. Oh, God. Allergies, man. Allergies will be the death of me. Okay. So before we go on to chapter 6, I'm going to peel my other clementine so that I can snack. Newark ham. I don't know how to pronounce that right. Newark ham. Thank you for the retweet. I appreciate that support. Same to Connor. Connor, thank you for the retweet. I appreciate that support, guys, and you putting my name out there. That peeling clementine sound is actually really, really nice. I really like that. Probably should have done it a little bit slower, but... Welcome back, Jacob. How was your trip home? Chat did get a bit more active, yes. Boring. Well, that's good. Means nothing bad came up. Uh-oh, Connor. I know from experience that's not a good thing. The sexy beast. The computer. Okay. Chapter 6. A dozen delays. Indeed, Mr. Molo. Merlanda can't carry 3 passengers, explained Litu. She's too small. Kale watched as Dar and the Emerlindian woman untied bundles from the dragon's back. Dar? Asked Litu with a frown on her face and a quick shake of her head. Did you bring your entire wardrobe? She gestured to the piles of parcels at his feet. We have miles to walk. You can't carry all that. And neither I nor Kale will carry it for you. These things aren't necessary. Let's be real. I still had joke of the night. What joke of the night, Connor? I'm confused. What's a synonym for grand in that context? Mood breaking. Dar bristled and muttered beneath his bushy mustache.
A person needs to look sharp, well-groomed. We represent Paladin. Who knows who we'll run into... Well, who knows who we'll run into on an important quest? We may be called upon to negotiate with rulers of distant realms.
We're going through forest and swamp. You don't need fine clothes and brilliant colors fit for a ball. Pick out sensible clothes in greens and browns, if you have any.
Oh, yes, Connor. Yes, indeed. Absolutely, that was definitely very amusing.
Magnificent, spectacular. Oh gosh, Mr. B. Oh wait, what's this? What's this? There's magic in the air. What's this? What's this? Santa's interaction announced that they're going to open a hands-on edutainment facility, Pokemon Expo Gym in Osaka. Oh my god. Hands-on edutainment facility for Pokemon in Japan. Five fans with advanced on Pokemon tips on using abilities, overall way for kids to also enjoy and learn to communicate with each other as part of the program.
Oh, that's fucking awesome. That's so cool. I wanna go.
You still have anime looking people though, which makes sense. That burp? Really? It's our city? Wait, what? I think it's actually... We hit transcodes, guys. I was gonna say, my computer isn't giving me any errors. An ad? It just means I have a lot of viewers, I'm sorry. What's the Clementine? Also, we did get a follow. Hold on. Corn Chowder, thank you for the follow. I'm glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. I hope you continue to enjoy, and welcome to the dark side. Transcode hype. Fucking finally transcodes. I'm sorry, Connor. I'm sorry that they weren't fast enough. That's super exciting. Thank you everyone for coming out and getting us to transcodes. Oh, alright, Umbreon. Have a good night. Song request isn't on, Connor. What song are you even requesting? What's This by Fall Out Boy? Not on Comfy Corner. I adore that song. But not on Comfy Corner. It defeats the relaxation purpose. Yes. Yes, I agree. I agree, Connor. It was necessary. But yes, have a good night, Umbreon. Sleep well. Salty peat is an important ingredient in gunpowder. What? What are you talking about, Mr. B? I was absolutely singing it. You're absolutely right. Alright, back to the book. Good night, everyone. Use's wish. Best wishes to everyone. Aww. Good night, Umbreon. I hope you have sweet dreams. Okay. Leetu left the canvas bag she'd removed from Merlander's back and came to stand before the grumbling Doniel. With her hands on her hips, she looked over his collection. Two bags, that's it. Two bags light enough for you to carry on your own.
We could stop at the next village and acquire a donkey,
suggested Dar. Two bags, said Leetu. Dar turned large, pleading brown eyes towards Kale.
Kale would carry a bag for me,
he said. Kale will have enough to carry. Quit this, Dar. Send the extra clothing back to the hall with Merlander. Salty Pete. What? What are you talking about, Salty Pete? I don't know who that is. Kiss Umbreon all the good. Aww. I'm with Connor on that one. It was absolutely necessary. I agree. It's a fantastic song. With what sounded very much like a growl, the Doniel conceded. Now that Leetu had won her point, she sat down against a tree and exhibited an amazing amount of... Wow, I can read. No, I can't right now. Okay. Okay. You keep repeating that. It doesn't help me understand, Mr. B. Now that Leetu had won her point, she sat down against a tree and exhibited an amazing amount of patience. She pulled out a book from her pocket and thumbed through the pages until she found a place to begin reading. It's used to make gunpowder. Oh, okay. But why did it come up? I don't understand. I'm so confused. Dar fiercely sorted through his belongings, working to pack as much into two bags as he could. He fussed over the bits and pieces of clothing, even trying on a rich green velvet coat, a silk shirt patterned in blue, and a crimson vest. Too bright, said Leetu, barely glancing up from her book. Dar sighed as he packed away the vest. He added a matching scarlet jacket, another vest, this one purple, and a green and gold pair of knickers. He muttered about people who did not appreciate the value of being properly attired and not having a mirror to make such important decisions. Oh, okay, Mr. B. But I still don't know how it came up in conversation. Oh god, now we're just throwing around different Pete's. Oh. Kale watched with amusement for a time. She had to admit the bright colors and fine fabrics attracted her too. For a moment, she allowed herself to hope, envisioning herself walking the marble corridors of the hall, wearing flowing garments of brightly colored silks. Eventually, she turned her mind to remembering the geography of Amara. The only map available in Riverway belonged to Dame Blizig, the schoolmistress. It had been several years since Kale studied the yellowed parchment, but she recalled the two mountain ranges running north and south, islands off the coast, volcanoes in the southeast, and massive forests in the northeast and southwest. A place called the Bogs covered a large area in the southwest. Her eyebrows shot up as she realized the only place where they could walk through both forest and swamps was in the southwest, nearly 1,000 miles away. We're going to walk to the Bogs? Litu's head jerked as she looked up from her book and stared at Kale. You very nearly shouted that at me, she said and closed her book. Seems I'd better pay more attention to you. You'll need to be able to contain your thoughts before we enter Betterman's Bog.
Why? What's in Betterman's Bog?
It's best you wait and see, Kale.
Kale didn't like the vague answer this time any more than she had the last. What about the promise to answer all her questions? She would try once more to get a straight answer. Are we going to walk to the Bogs?
She asked, looking toward the Darniel, hoping he would blurt out his thoughts. He seemed more willing to impart usable bits of information than Leetu. Dar, fretting over his bundles, didn't interject an answer.
Yes, we'll walk, said Leetu. But we'll go through a gateway.
Kale's mouth dropped open. Gateways were part of fairy tales. Heroes escaped through gateways or sprang upon unsuspecting foes from gateways. Gateways went hand in hand with talking animals and magical amulets.
Gateways are real?
Kale closed her mouth and slowly shook her head from side to side. Councilman Mager was right. She didn't know anything.
Okay, let's see here.
Potassium nitrate.
Now it makes sense.
Okay, to other people.
And Ray, why does anything get talked about in this chat? Most of us are a bunch of weirdos who make grin. Okay, you're not wrong, Connor. You're absolutely not wrong. I like cats. Cats are wonderful. I want a cat. When I have my own apartment, I will get a cat. I think that says Green Car 86. That's what it looks like. Green Car 86, thank you for the follow. I'm glad you're enjoying the stream thus far. I hope you continue to enjoy, and welcome to the dork side. How are you doing tonight? Anyone want a nice fresh mint cup? Oh, like a cupcake. The pre-dark elements are older.
Oh, what?
Thunderspin is long and what? Oh, okay. Green Scar. Oh, I apologize. Green Scar 86. Thank you for the follow. Glad you've enjoyed the stream thus far. I hope you continue to enjoy. And welcome to the dork side. Sorry, I need to figure out a way to make the words on that follower alert pop. I can't do an outline, so I gotta figure something out with it. But we'll see. We'll see what I can figure out. I have such a hard time reading it. Going for the... I would use the booty command, but it doesn't work right now.
Ask the cutie before you touch the booty.
Alright, let's continue on with the book. Okay.
I'm ready,
announced Star. He gave Merlander a pat on her neck, and the dragon rose to her feet. The Donniel stepped back to avoid being struck by her wings. She lifted into the air with his extra packs lashed firmly to her saddle. Dar watched her climb high into the cloudless blue sky and set off toward Vendela. He turned a grumpy face to Leetu, Benz, and Kale. The Merlindian sprang to her feet and hoisted a pack into the air. She pitched it to Kale, who caught it with a grunt. Without a word, Leetu grabbed two more bundles and swung them over her shoulder. She started down a path beside the stream. Kale scrambled to her feet just in time to follow Dar as he plodded down the trail. They trekked on, the sun warming their backs, birds singing in the towering trees, and the brook babbling among the round rocks. Occasionally, the knotted roots of giant evergreens extended into the stream. Here, the water frothed and churned through the bare, brown footing of the mighty trees. McCall will win. Oh, God. Is McCall here? Did I miss it? Or are we just talking about McCall beating out storms? I don't see McCall's name. High five, Jacob. Nice. Congrats, guys. Okay. Soon Dar began to hum, and then sing softly under his breath. He'd regained his good humor. He sang louder, and his songs grew livelier as they marched along. Kale's spirits responded to the happy tunes of the legendary heroes among the seven high races. Dar also sang of farmers and other ordinary folk caught in funny circumstances. She laughed and gasped at all the trials that could befall a traveler. They rambled down the mountain, then across a valley, and started climbing again. Dar ran out of breath as the path grew steeper. They could no longer step lively to his cheerful beat. Kale, though used to working hard, was not accustomed to long treks. Her legs protested. She very much wanted to rest. Dar stopped suddenly, and for a moment, Kale thought she'd get her wish. But the Donnie lifted his nose to the breeze and closed his eyes. Leetu stopped and turned. "Grawligs," she said, obviously reading his mind. "How far do you think?" She looked at Dar.
"Half a mile."
"Which direction?" Dar puzzled over that for a moment, sniffing the air.
"We're surrounded."
Kale thought she'd been too tired to go much further, but now a shiver of fear energized her muscles. She was ready to run as soon as Leetu gave the order. The Emerlindian examined the trees and bushes surrounding the small clearing. "We'll make our stand here." "Surely they should run." Kale opened her mouth to protest. Nothing but a croak came out. Impatient, Leetu beckoned with a brisk gesture, and Kale hurried to the Emerlindian's side. Leetu threw her own burden into the bushes, then snatched Kale's bundle from her back and hurled it into the undergrowth as well. "Daw, you take the center of the clearing," Leetu ordered. "Kale, climb this tree." Kale looked at the thick trunk of the towering evergreen. She'd seen several of these imposing trees on the trail she'd taken through mountain passes. None like it grew around river away. "This is a rock pine," explained Leetu, again demonstrating she knew Kale's thoughts. "Its name doesn't come from growing in rocks. Those prickly pine cones are as heavy as stones. Climb as high as you can. Take off your tunic and wrap it around your throwing hand. When the Grawlogs attack, stop pelting them with the rock cones. Hit anything you can, but aim for the Grawlogs' ears. They're tender." Leetu made a boosting step with interlaced fingers. Kale put her foot into Leetu's hands and felt herself thrust into the air. She grabbed the lowest branch and clambered up the tree. The grunts and coarse mutterings of the approaching Grawlogs inspired extra speed. Once perched on a high branch, she could see dark forms advancing from all sides, completely encircling them. "How many?" asked Leetu from below. Kale scanned the area.
12.
"That shouldn't delay us too long," said Dar.
Branches in a tree next to Kale swayed. She made out the slender form of Leetu as she climbed to a branch 30 feet above the ground. Below, Dar stood in the center of the clearing with his ears perked, listening to the approach of the marauding mountain ogres. Kale wanted to shout,
"Climb a tree!"
"He'll be all right,"
Leetu's voice, calm voice, reassured her.
"Just watch. He'll throw up a magic shell and fight from beneath."
At that moment, four Grawlugs crashed through a line of brushwood and entered the clearing. Dar hunched over, and a shimmering shell appeared over his body. It hovered above him like an inverted glass bowl. Kale could see the Donnell's movements within. Two daggers flashed in his hands. The Grawlugs gave a roar and charged. They beat on the shell and tried to pry it up. Dar's hands whipped out from the lower rim. His daggers slashed and poked at the Grawlug's toes, as well as their fingers, when they gripped the edge of his protective armor. The Grawlugs hopped around amid yelps and howls, but didn't give up. As one fell back to suck on his injured fingers, another took his place.
"Now!"
cried Leetu's voice in Kale's mind, startling her so that she almost lost her grip on the branch. More of the mountain ogres poured into the clearing. Their massive legs tore through the thick underbrush. They bellowed a war cry, and Kale clutched the tree trunk, thinking the horrendous shouting would shake her out of the tree. Dar disappeared in the middle of a dozen raving Grawlugs. Arrows from the Immerlindian's bow rained down upon the ogres' heads.
"I can't just sit here. I'm supposed to help."
Kale wiggled out of her tunic and wrapped it hastily around her right hand. She grabbed a pine cone and had to twist at the woody, seed-bearing orb to make it come loose. Even with her hand protected, she felt the pricks of the barbs. She hurled the rock-heavy cone down wildly and... Holy poop, it's late. I should probably sleep.
Yes, Connor, get some sleep. Get some sleep.
Let's see. So Pyre, because my internet went out last night and I didn't see till now that you scorched me on my highest last night. Here this is now. Do you even English? No, Mr. B. Do that speak English and what? What? Ain't no country. What movie? Ray should also probably sleep.
You're not wrong.
I want to do... Well, I need to at least finish this chapter. Yeah, we'll answer this chapter, and then that'll be it. I wasn't able to start until 1 a.m. It is, Jacob, yes, it is. I wasn't able to start until 1 because, my room was such a mess from getting new internet, and, it's not listed in the commands. I haven't fixed that yet.
Smeep, I just got here. I'm sorry, que pasa?
But it is 4 a.m., but I'm gonna finish this chapter. I am gonna finish this chapter, so. And then I'll probably, like, talk a little bit, because we all know that's what I like to do. I think there's a slight cooldown on it, Mr. B. Sleep now. Okay. Go to sleep.
Mr. B, let me finish the chapter. Okay. Go to sleep, Bella. Oh, God. Even with her hand protected, she felt the pricks of the barbs. She hurled the rock-heavy cone down wildly and managed to hit one of the Grawlugs on his hairy back. The cone clung to the matted hair. Over the next few minutes, her aim improved, as did her ability to twist the cones in just the right way to pull them off the bushy, needle-laden branches. She climbed to different limbs several times in order to reach more clusters of the spiny weapons. Kale began to see the advantage of Leetu's strategy, while Dar, in the relative safety of his shell, inflicted grievous wounds on the ogres. Leetu peppered them from above with arrow after arrow. The rock-hard pine cones Kale threw bruised the ogres, but did not impede their attack. Nonetheless, the cones stuck, and Kale saw that was a good thing. Most of the hairy Grawlugs carried the extra weight of 10 to 20 rock cones. She thought the beasts were incredibly stupid. Their focus remained riveted on the Donita they thought they had trapped on the ground. Eventually, the assault from above bothered some of the Grawlugs enough that they stopped to gawk at the trees. Leetu took advantage of the upturned faces. Her skillful aim sent several Grawlugs howling into the woods, pulling at arrows embedded in their flesh. No, yeah, it's not a target command, Connor. Bolo is a grown adult who makes all the sound decisions. Bringing some radiant to chat? Absolutely, yes. I like the Fallout Boy, what's this? But yes, the original Nightmare Before Christmas is best, but Fallout Boy is awesome. I kind of love Fallout Boy, not gonna lie. I am not ashamed. Okay. Kale marveled over each direct hit on the Grawlug's ear. They reacted with shrieks of anger and pain. Often, the wounded Grawlug left the fray with a massive hand covering the side of its head. All the Grawlugs were limping painfully from the wounds inflicted to their feet by the Donita. She redoubled her efforts to make a bullseye, then laughed to herself and corrected the phrase. She wanted to hit a Grawlug's ear, not a bullseye. The skirmish was soon over.
Dar was right. They're leaving. And none too soon. My arm aches from throwing all those heavy cones. I must have thrown a couple hundred. And my hands feel like I've been squeezing pincushions.
She reached inside her shirt and pulled out the red pouch to cradle between her palms. For a moment, Dar, Leetu, and Kale remained still, listening to the Grawlugs scrambling through the forest, howling and snarling, and making just as much noise in their departure as they had in the attack. As the sounds faded, Dar released the protective shell. It vanished. He stood and sniffed the air.
"They're gone,"
he announced. He cleaned his bloody daggers, wiping them on the trampled glass. Grass. Wiping them on the trampled grass. They disappeared into his sleeves, and the fuzzy Donita... Fussy. This is why I need to go to bed. My reading is suffering. How can there not be a sleep command in a stream that goes until after 4 a.m.? There is. It's sheep. It's 2 a.m. for me. Quit trying to make Ray sleep. Que pasa? It may be 2 a.m. for you, but it's 4 a.m. for me. You don't tell me what to do. So many commands. But I do have the sleep. I just don't have the targeted sleep command. I will see about making one. Hello, Goki.
That's just saying you're going to bed, Mr. B. It's not targeted. It's user. Sorry. Okay. Let me, down for it so that people don't just spam it into my chat. I need to stop laughing. Oh. 5 a.m. for you guys. You guys need to sleep. I'm glad that you're enjoying the stream, though. I will say that. I am definitely happy you're enjoying the stream. Enough to hang around until 5 in the morning. Oh, my face hurts from laughing. Oh my gosh. Take a breath. Funny. It's actually not that funny, but it's 4 a.m. and so everything's funny to me. Okay. Okay. Oh, okay.
They're gone,
he announced. He cleaned his bloody daggers, wiping them on the trampled grass. They disappeared into his sleeves, and the fussy Daniel inspected his spattered knickers. Leetu slithered from branch to branch and landed lightly on the ground. Messy walk, she commented, and began to pick up arrows that had bounced off the Grolog's hard heads or been pulled out and thrown down by the angry beasts. Kale came down from her tree more slowly. She'd been in a battle. If she wanted to believe it a dream, she couldn't. Splashes of Grolog blood spotted the little clearing. It crept to the far edge to sit apart from her companion. Oh, I'm sorry. She crept from the far edge. Words. No, no, sleep me, no, sleep me, never me, robot.
Aw.
It's a clementine allergy. Oh, jeez, you're losing it a little bit. This happens when I haven't been sleeping well. I get a little bit punch drunk, so. She crept to the far edge to sit apart from her companions. Her stomach felt queasy, and she didn't want to talk to anyone. Dar had already pulled off his boots and socks and had one of his bags open, looking for clean clothes. It's all right. Kale heard Leetu's calm voice in her mind, but could not bring herself to look up at the Emerlindian's serene features. Instead, she studied the twigs, dirt, and pebbles beneath her feet. An insect crawled across an open space and then disappeared underneath a Tranganog leaf. Kale deliberately answered Leetu with her thoughts. One of the fighting Miriones from Wivra Way had been to the Borderlands and fought Blimits. He said killing Blimits was no more bothersome than swatting flies. His stomach didn't turn at the sight of blood. If Paladin expects me to fight in battles, maybe he picked the wrong Orant. Leetu's voice penetrated her mind. Don't feel bad about being sick over this sort of thing. Don't ever get used to killing. If you do,
then no matter how high you were born in the seven races, you'll slip down to the level of those born of Pretender's evil mind.
Paladin approves of killing?
Asked Kale. A long pause followed. Paladin believes in protecting his people.
What does that mean?
It's better you wait and see. Kale growled under her breath and heard Lethu's answering chuckle in her mind as well as in her ears. Okay, so that's the end of that chapter.
Go to bed, you're drunk.
Punch drunk, yes. I have not had any alcohol, so there's that. And between sleep and clear thinking, is a beautiful place. JK, JK, don't look at the past.
Oh, goodness.
I'm tired. Alright, so that's where we're going to end the book for tonight. We'll start with chapter 7 tomorrow. Do I have a bookmark? I don't. I need something to use as a bookmark. I am not bending the page. Nope, that's too big. I don't like bending the pages of my books. I'll use that for now, and then I'll find a real bookmark. I've worked in too many libraries to bend to be comfortable with bending the pages of my books. So, anyway, as far as the egg goes, this is my dragon egg. I just like to have it when I read this book, because it describes the dragon eggs that Kale has as rock-like and smooth, and gradually warm. When she holds them in her hands. I've always thought, ever since my mom gave me this, I've always thought of it as a dragon's egg. So I just like pretending that it is one and playing with it a bit, so. Oops, that didn't help when I hit it against the microphone, but. What's that for? What's that link for, Mudguts? I can give you a permit if you let me know what it's for. But yeah, so that was the first six chapters of the book. The Ultimate Dog Ear. Oh, that's gonna cause me pain. But we'll go ahead and... Is it one of those ones where you're supposed to fold it and it makes a picture or whatever? I do like those. I do think those are kind of cool. But at the same time...
Okay, you've got a permit, so you can go ahead and give the link. Indeed, Goki. I've always had a very vivid imagination. And it does. I think it does help me in a lot of ways, so. Let's see this. To help if my computer... worked properly. It won't let me see it. Why won't it let me see it? Oh, thank you, Kibasa. Indeed. Indeed, Goki. Good night, Connor. Sleep well. Thanks for stopping by. Thank you for the host. See you probably tomorrow, because you tend to come around a lot. It's why you're a mod. One of the reasons you're a mod. But yeah, have a great night. Sleeps well. Oh my goodness. I am also getting really tired. So, but I hope you guys enjoyed the book. We will be reading more of it. Actually, next week, I'm not sure if we're going to continue with Dragonspell, or I might take next week off from Dragonspell. We'll still do a Comfy Corner stream. No need to worry about that. But I may do... spooky stories or spooky stories. Mr. Bolo, really? Really, Mr. B? Oh, you goof. Oh, okay, that startled me. But yes, we may do spooky stories for Comfy Corner next week, since it's the Wednesday before Halloween. I will be streaming again tomorrow, or I guess later tonight, so Thursday evening. I believe probably around 9:30 is when I would like to start. Hopefully that'll end up working out for me. And that's just going to be a regular video game stream. I'll be playing more Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask. Also, that's 9:30 p.m. Central Time, for those that don't know. Or for those that are in different time zones, rather. So for me, it's currently 4:30 a.m. So wherever you fall in that, add or subtract that to 9:30 p.m. And that will be more Majora's Mask. So lots of high blood pressure rage and... me making very annoyed noises at the computer. And then we will have our Fiber Friday. If you're into creative, crafty streams, we will have that on Friday evening after I get off work. But yeah. So... I hate Major QQ. What? 10:30 p.m. for EST. Thank you, Danny. Thank you. 7:30 p.m. PST.
Thank you for doing the math for me.
Danny, you're wonderful. If you guys would like to follow me on any of those social network, Twitter, I'm up. Cry, cry. Oh, okay. Oh, hush, Mr. B. The next Comfy Corner will be next Wednesday. Like I said, I don't know if it'll be... I'm thinking I might do spooky stories, if I can find some good ones, like, on the internet or something. We may do spooky stories instead of Dragonspell. We will definitely be reading Dragonspell the week after. Unless something comes up, but it shouldn't. But yeah, about my social media, Twitter, I'm on very frequently, pretty much all the time I'm on Twitter. You can also follow me on Instagram. I try to keep that, somewhat updated at least with, my artwork, with the needle felting and such. The Tumblr is for my needle felting projects. I haven't updated it lately, for my creative projects. I haven't updated that lately, but I need to more. And then YouTube. If you're enjoying the books, if you're a Brit, it'll be like 4:30 a.m. If you're enjoying the books, I do upload these Comfy Corner streams onto YouTube. So that will be, you can get the entirety of the Tale of Despero book. It's in two parts. That is there on, YouTube. And then as soon as I get off tonight, I'll be uploading this stream onto YouTube. So that, if you want to hear the all six chapters that we read tonight, you'll be able to. If you came in late, or if you've fallen asleep and you can't hear me right now, but hey. That is, once again, all available on YouTube. Right now it's just the Comfy Corner streams that I have available, from my streaming. There's some older videos on there as well, if you really want to watch them. But yeah, so that's all my social media. Also, you guys, I am part of an unofficial team here on Twitch. We're not official because none of us are partnered, so we can't make it an official team. But we're known as the Odd Streamers. That's Optimistically Delightful Dorky Streamers. And you should absolutely give all four of those wonderful people a follow. They're fantastic streamers. Storms and I have a weekly dual cast on Sundays. And Rainy's just wonderful. I think she's going to be starting again next week. I think, if I remember right, she's going to be starting streaming again. And then Todd and Boo are just freaking wonderful casters. So you should give all those lovely people a follow. If a Clementine and a Dragon Egg were to duel, oh boy. I don't have a Clementine to try it. But thank you all. Oh, you know what? I was gonna see if there was anyone we wanted to raid tonight. She gets back next week. Okay, thank you, Danny. Probably give her a week. Okay. I will do my best to stay warm. Okay, let me see if there's anyone I want to raid. How would you guys feel about watching, we've got a friend of the stream, Zone. He's usually
hangs out in here sometimes. And he is currently streaming League of Legends. How would you guys feel about joining me on a raid to just go over to his stream? Because while I might be done for the night, you guys might not be done watching. Now, granted, this won't be another ASMR stream. So if that's your... if that's kind of what you're going for tonight... I know, let's raid Dorky Ray. Nice try, Kepasa. But Zone's an awesome friend of the stream. And a pretty cool dude. So if you guys would be willing to come on a raid with me, go ahead and type that in. The way that works is you go into his chat and sit there quietly. Don't say anything until you see me put up the call sign, hashtag Dorky Raid. And once you see that, you're going to post hashtag Dorky Raid. Once again, it's just a way to open you guys up to new streamers, open them up to new viewers. It's a lot of fun. I enjoy it a lot. No worries, Mr. Bello. No worries at all. So. Oh, it helps if I do things properly. Oops. Okay, there we go. But yeah, thank you guys all so much for coming out. Thank you everyone who gave me a follow today. Super appreciated. Super encouraging. Especially because I wasn't sure if I wanted to do these kind of streams, and it makes me feel great that, you guys were, that you guys are enjoying it enough to follow. You guys could have chosen to be anywhere tonight. You chose to spend it with me. I super appreciate that. We are going to be raiding Kepasa, in just a second. I just haven't dropped the call sign yet. Looks like someone may have already, though. Fail on my part. Okay, no worries, Kepasa. But yeah, so I will see you all tomorrow. I hope you all have a fantastic evening or day or whatever it may be for you. I will see you next time. Have a fantastic night. I may see some of you over in Zone's channel, so that would be awesome. See you guys all later.